Like a chrysalis, we're emerging from the economy of the Industrial Revolution. An economy confined to and limited by the Earth's physical resources, into the economy in mind, in which there are no bounds on human imagination, and the freedom to create is the most precious natural resource.
Welcome to the Soul of Enterprise, Business and the Knowledge Economy, sponsored by Sage, transforming the way people think and work so their organizations can thrive. I'm Ron Baker, along with my good friend and Verisage Institute colleague, Ed Kless. On today's show, folks, we're going to be talking about the management myth with the author that we've been trying to get since day one of our show, Ed, Matthew Stewart. So, Ed, how's it going?
I'm really excited to be on today. I'm really thrilled that Matthew's finally been able to join us. He was the, as you were saying to him, the most mentioned author on our show and was mentioned in show one that we did.
Absolutely. And I'll talk to him about that. But Matthew, welcome to the Soul of Enterprise.
Well, hey, great to be here, Ron and Ed. And really, I'm honored to be number one, I guess, on your first show.
You're 332 shows late, as far as we're concerned, but that's okay. We eventually got you. Matthew, I don't even want to take time reading your bio, so other than to say that you graduated from Princeton University in 85 with a concentration in political philosophy, and then you went to Oxford, where you earned a doctor of philosophy in 1988. And I think German philosophy, 19th century German philosophy, if I'm not mistaken. How does a guy who's got a doctorate in philosophy end up in management consulting?
Well, it's clearly one of those things that probably should not have happened. And in maybe in the best of all possible worlds, it would not have happened. I am an intellectual at heart. I have to confess to that. But I found that philosophy was just not working for me. I remember one day I was talking with a professor, and he had a question that went something like, if a married man travels back in time and marries somebody else, is he a bigamist? And I thought, wow. You know, with questions like that, I don't think I really want to know the answer. I also thought that maybe philosophy wasn't what he really needed to be talking about. And so philosophy was not working for me. And I saw that the people around me who were even less qualified than me were getting all these jobs with management consulting firms and investment banks. I really didn't know what I was getting into. I sent off a few letters. I got a job. I needed a job at the time. So in some ways, it was kind of pedestrian. But I'll just say one other thing about it that I think is important. I actually thought there was something interesting about going into consulting in a kind of intellectual way. I mean, I thought that, my issues with philosophy were that it was a kind of constructed or fake discipline. And I thought, well, management, these issues of business are going to be serious in some way. There's going to be some problems to solve, some things to think about that will have some impact somewhere. So I think there was a good side to that accident too.
Right. I think we crossed paths. I went into business as a CPA, and now later in life wish I had the degree in philosophy instead. You kind of went the other way, and then you probably learned to appreciate philosophy more once you started getting into the management literature.
Yeah. Can I just say something about that too? Because I feel bad, and I don't want to suggest that philosophy is a complete completely academic discipline, a waste of time and so on. There's a lot there. And I think you're absolutely right. I sort of got a better perspective on it from the outside. So I think there's a lot there and a lot to study. It's just that, you also have to get out of it to see it.
Right. Well, your book, The Management Myth, which came out in 2009, and it's based on an article, or you'd written the article in The Atlantic first, as we talked about in June of 2006. And we're going to put both on the show notes. Folks, you've got to read both. You've got to read the book and you've got to read the Atlantic article because they really go well together. And the book traces, like you say, the genealogy of the management literature discipline, whatever you want to call it. You expose its flaws and then you want to replace it. And you say, it's not a discipline, but an idea of one. And I always thought the two biggest oxymorons were political science and scientific management. Scientific management isn't a science, is it? It's a business.
Yeah, that's really, I think, one of the fundamental lessons that I got out of it. And I should say, by way of background, that there's this other paradox that I went into management consulting. I spent 10 years on and off in that business. And then and during that whole time, I really didn't read much management, didn't really have management theory or scientific management. I only got to it afterwards. And then it kind of made sense. And I was able to put the two together. And yes, at the core of that, at the core, I think, of the issues with this body of management theory and so on, is this kind of false idea of what management is. And the most difficult idea, the one that causes the most problems, is this idea that management is a science. It's kind of a form of engineering. And you can sort of, you know, master it with Frederick Taylor's, you know, little laws of efficiency, and train people in it and have them go out and apply it. And that I think demonstrably leads to very, very problematic results.
Right. I know, I love how you say that management theorists lack depth, because they've been doing for only about a century what philosophers have been doing for millennia, which is, you know, studying human behavior. And we have a saying around here that if you want knowledge, read nonfiction, but if you want wisdom, read literature or philosophy. Yeah. I'd probably add to that.
I'm pleased to see that you're an advocate for the humanities. I mean, they're pretty seriously bashed today. But I think there are good reasons for that criticism. But if we approach them the right way, I think that they can be tremendously instructive. And I think that's, I guess, the one of the central messages that I wanted to get across. I'm so glad you brought it out. It's that if you approach the humanities right the right way, then yeah, they can provide some of that sort of human wisdom that you need in order to, you know, do the leadership and do the actual things that management requires.
Right. And this is a scary question for me. Matthew is the author of 7 quote unquote business books, but how can so many bad books sell so well?
Well, you know, there are a lot of bad books on religion too. I mean, there's plenty of
True. Categories
that have pretty weak production. And the reason for it is that people are hungry for answers. And, you know, I take it as evidence of an unmet demand and evidence that maybe we haven't quite approached it seriously enough. But essentially, we're kind of, you know, we've turned that market over to a bunch of, excuse me, Ron, I don't mean this personally, but, you know, sort of showmen in the carnival barkers, when maybe it should be taken a little more seriously. And then I think you'd get better books. But yeah, it's a problem. And I have to say that what inspired that Atlantic article was in fact this experience of, you know, picking up these books that I'd never read, but I sort of bought while I was a consultant, and I picked them up and I read them. It was horrifying. I mean,
you don't have to qualify. I'm very aware of it. We joke around here that the library shelves in hell are stocked with business books, and the ones in heaven have literature. You quote an old professor, Matthew, and I love this. He says, "How can so many who know so little make so much by telling other people how to do the jobs they are paid to know how to do?" Do you have a theory for why organizations continue to hire consultants, or theories?
Yeah. Right. So there have to be many theories, I should say, by not qualification, because consulting is a whole bunch of things. But there's basically two sides of any theory. One is the good theory that says, okay, they're doing something. The other one is the bad theory. Here's the good theory, the reason that where it does make some sense. Organizations always get locked in their bubbles. So, you know, having that outside thing is important. I think that's kind of the fundamental basis of a good theory of consulting. Here's the bad theory of consulting. It's that organizations and especially their top leaders are they're insecure and they need backing or reinforcement to make decisions that they don't really want to make. And so they bring in the outside forces to essentially not to tell them what to do because they kind of know usually, but rather to enforce those decisions and to kind of make it possible to happen. So that's why, you know, a really big chunk of consulting is really, you know, when I was in the business, we just called it was some form of cost cutting or other. I mean, it was either headcount cutting, overhead reduction, or sourcing, or other things like that. That's kind of the bread and butter of a lot of consulting. And it's essentially just a way of kind of bringing in an outsider to impose the discipline that the insiders don't want to impose. And I guess you can still split that into a little bit of a good and bad, because sometimes there is an efficiency gain there. But very often it's just a matter of a power struggle, and it's using the outsiders to kind of for that extra edge.
Right.
Although I have to say, Ron, you've been in the business. I'm curious to hear what your theories are, because I'm sure you've got some ideas of what.
I think you nailed it. I think bringing in that outside perspective, I think because you can't be a prophet in your own land. So if some outside expert, confirmation of authority, right, comes in and says, oh, you need to be doing this or whatever, then people are more likely to buy in. Yeah, I think there's, like you said, multi-factor reasons for it. Matthew, I read your book on a plane to Australia, and I had already written a couple books trying to trash Taylor, and I thought I did a pretty effective job until I read your book. You tore him down from his pedestal and buried him in the ground and nailed the coffin shut. And yet he keeps rearing his ugly head. We have a special loathing here for Frederick Taylor because he influenced the first lawyer to implement both the billable hour and the timesheet into a law firm in 1919. Harvard grad lawyer, heavily influenced by the zeitgeist of the day, which was Taylorism, scientific management, the whole nine yards. And it's been a blight on the professions ever since. And it's still around, and it's 100 years later.
Yeah, I think when someone survives like that, you have to appreciate that he's surviving because he's an idea. I mean, he fulfills some expectation that people have, some hope they have. But that's why I thought it was so important, as you say, to kind of, you know, rip him to shreds and bury him underground. I like the way you said it, because, you know, we got to show that look at that idea and recognize it for what it is, right? Don't pretend that this man who came up with it, that he's actually an authority who can, you know, give you the foundation in science to support that idea. Because, I mean, I'm happy to go over all those tales, but boy, if your listeners haven't heard them, they need to know about the stuff this guy made up, right?
It's fudge factor. And you do a great job pulling down all the other gurus too, Collins, Peters, even Drucker. And Drucker's kind of a saint around here with recognized flaws. And totally, you pointed them out, and I think you nailed it. Unfortunately, Matthew, we're up against our first break, and folks, would like to remind you, if you want to contact Ed or me, send us an email to asktsoe@verisage.com. Check out patreon.com/tsoe so you can subscribe to the show and get bonus content and our bonus episodes and commercial-free regular episodes. And our Patreon site is now sponsored by 90 Minds. Get ahead. Hire a mind. Check them out at 90minds.com. And now a word from our sponsors.
Become our friend on Facebook. Post your thoughts about our shows and network on our timeline. Visit facebook.com/voiceamerica.
Sage provides accountants with compliance, reporting, and analytic solutions to do more for their clients. These solutions include education programs such as the Sage Accountants Network Client Advisory Service Program. This program delivers the tools to create, package, price, market, and deliver additional services to clients, increasing your profitability and delivering more value to your clients. Let Sage help you grow your business by visiting sageaccountantsnetwork.com.
Have you ever read a book that changed your life? I sure have. Have you ever listened to an advertisement for a book so many times that you question the existence of God? Me too. Hello, I'm Greg Kite. I recorded the advertisement for Ron and Ed's book, The Soul of Enterprise Dialogues on Blah, 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 Whatever. And 4 years later, we're all tired of it, especially me. But thankfully, there's a solution. For just $10 a month, you never have to hear my voice again. For a commercial-free version of The Soul of Enterprise, go to patreon.com/TSOE and subscribe now.
We're always talking business. Talk to an expert. Call now, toll free, 866-472-5790. That's 866-472-5790. Voice America Business Network.
We're tuned into The Soul of Enterprise with Ron Baker and Ed Kless. To find out more about our show, visit us on the web at thesoulofenterprise.com. You can also chat with us on Twitter using hashtag AskTSOE. Now, back to The Soul of Enterprise.
Folks, we are back with the author of The Management Myth, Why Experts Keep Getting It Wrong, Matthew Stewart. Pleased to have you on, Matthew. And I want to just jump in from page 3 of your book. Like all consultants, I owe my education to the extraordinary generosity of my clients. And I wrote next to it in the margin, amen. And one of the things that I think is important to me as a professional consultant for a long time, when I did much more consulting day to day, was some of the philosophies of Peter Block, who taught me that when done well, and I agree with you that it's often not done well, consultants can be a model for behavior for how organizations should move forward even after the consultant moves on. And one of the best compliments that I ever received in a consultant role was when they would say to me, Ed, you've taught us how we can begin to solve our problems on our own once you're gone. And I think when done well, that can be one of the powers of consulting. So your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I mean, that's a great point, and it really resonates with my experience. I'll tell you in a couple of ways. So one is I was lucky enough to do a lot of international cross-border type assignments. So I worked in Spain, I worked in Switzerland, I worked in France and in Germany. I spent a year in Mexico. And I think that sometimes what we could contribute to the client organizations was, in fact, a certain kind of culture, right? A certain and I think there were two really beneficial aspects of the culture that I thought we could often bring. One is that we just ask a lot of questions, right? We ask people to think about things. We ask people to the brainstorming sessions. Some of them are corny. Some of the questions are obvious. But in large organizations, you often find that this kind of sclerosis sets in and people aren't asking the questions. They aren't realizing that they can actually get somewhere with that. And I think that we brought some of that. Then the other thing that we brought, which is much more straightforward, is a certain analytic discipline, right? I mean, as consultants, the one thing that you do over and over again is you look for those numbers and you try to show that, come up with some analysis that you can back up with more than just gut intuition. And I think that's another thing that can be very helpful in client organizations. But of course, the piece that you cited, admittedly a little snarky, okay, the book has a little kind of edge like that. I appreciate you going along with that. It reflects the reverse process of that learning. I mean, I was so fortunate because I went to all these different organizations, and I went there not knowing really very much about the context. To call me an expert would be, that would be an insult to Frederick Winslow Taylor, for example. And yet I learned a lot, and to some degree, I think I was then passed some of that along to others. So I think it's really important for people to understand that there are these really complex ecosystems, and consulting is now part of a kind of complex business managerial thing. And it does have some positive functions in like distributing culture, distributing best practices that go beyond just business practices, but I think extend into the realm of culture and general approaches and attitudes and thoughts.
Well, one of the things Ron and I talk about is the social capital. And in a way, consulting can be a form of social capital as you move from organization to organization and bring some of those, as you say, I hate the term best practices, but really more the philosophical point. But this leads me now to something that I've been wanting to ask you for a long, long time, ever since I've read your book. I want you to talk to us about the tool, the main tool in any consulting engagement, the whale.
It's too bad we can't show your listeners some slides, I guess, but there they
are. We'll put the graphic up, so they'll have
I'm sure you're familiar, and perhaps most of your listeners are familiar with the 20-80 rule or the 80-20 rule, the Pareto laws, and so on. And I guess it comes down to this very simple insight that applies to so many processes in business, in life, adding up insects in your room, something like that, that basically 20% of the observations account for 80% of the effects or results. So in the case of customers, you find that 20% of your customers account for 80% of the revenues and so on. And then it gets even more complicated because it turns out that when you're looking at profitability as opposed to revenue, you get a sort of more complex function where maybe 20% of your customers might account for 200% of your profit. And then you've got another, group of losers on the other end that account for negative 100%. And so you get this kind of funny curve-like shape. And it turns out that that curve will show up in any number of business processes. If you go look at a retail banking operation or credit cards, those are the kind of things that I focused on. Or if you look at car manufacturing or tennis ball manufacturing, you're going to find that kind of curve. And here's the short story of it, though. That curve will tell you something, but you can easily imagine that it tells you too much. So you've got to basically figure out what it's telling you, but not go too far and just think, okay, the answer is here. The whale has shown me the way, because that doesn't quite happen. I could go on, by the way, because I one thing that happens in the book is, you realize I have this kind of sort of crazy intellectual, and I had read too many books growing up. And so Moby Dick was one of my favorite books in high school. Yeah, so I carried with me. So there's a kind of a white whale theme running through the book, and I wanted to describe this hunt for the white whale going on in our consulting business. So anyway, it's a long story, but it was fun.
Yeah. No, it's a great tool. I'll often put that graphic up and shout, "There she blows," because it's like you find it everywhere. It's a truism in a lot of places. I wanted to share this with you. It got expressed to me this way in one organization. Ed, you have to understand, here at X organization, the spreadsheet is mightier than the sword.
Yeah. No, that's right. I took on some of that. So here I write books critiquing that whole thing, right? But when it comes to like analyzing some of our household issues, I will occasionally pull out a spreadsheet and use it to completely dominate the rest of the household and tell them what has to be done. So it is useful. But the other, of course, cautionary insight is that the whale can be seductive because, you look at it and think, okay, all I have to do is get rid of the 10% of customers who are losing me all the money and hold on to the 20% who are making me all the money and get rid of the ones in between who are nobodies, except that there's often a lot of complexity, right? Because maybe that 10% are customers who are in an early stage and then need to, progress to the happy side of the whale. So it's a tool that can open up doors, but you just have to, it doesn't necessarily give you the answer directly.
One of my favorite insights was in one of Edwin Tufte's book, and he is citing somebody else. I can't remember the name of the other author who did an executive summary of executive summaries. He read like 10,000 executive summaries and then wrote an executive summary of them. And it came down to 3 points. And it's one, some do, some don't. Point number two, the differences aren't very great. Point number three, it's more complicated than that.
Yeah.
And that's ultimately what the whale tells you. It can give you some insight, as you say, depending upon how the whale is drawn in a particular company. But what you then have to do with it is really up to you. I want to share with you one other thing that has happened to me as an inspiration to you and a nod to you. I was in a meeting a couple of years ago. I've been with Sage for 17 years. So this was a previous regime that really got into ROI analysis. What's the ROI? So we had we had this spreadsheets of ROI, and you had to fit your thing into the ROI. And I asked during a meeting, again, inspired by you, has anyone done the ROI of the ROI tool?
Right.
And of course, the answer is no. They look at you like you're insane. Like, well, because it's self-evident, right, Matthew? It's the ROI tool must be right.
Yeah, but Ed, you got to be careful because you're going to work yourself out of a job. It's kind of what happened to me, right? I mean, Ron was talking about the impact of studying philosophy, and I was just, thinking about that. I think it gave me a perspective on management issues, but then at the same time, it also ultimately led me to leave the management stuff because, it was philosophically interesting, but only up to a point that I had to kind of move beyond. So I'm just concerned, Ed. I don't want you to go too far with this ROI, because it could lead you to a dark place.
A very dark place. Well, one last question before the break. You talked about the impact of your customers, as we would say, had on you and the learning that you've done from them, and I think that's great. Do you ever have an experience where the client was inviting you into their bubble and wanted you to be part of their bubble? In other words, we talked earlier about sometimes being the outsider is helpful, but a lot of cases they want you to continue the self-deception. And did you ever have experience with that where they'd want to continue with the bad story that was happening?
Oh yeah. I mean, and unfortunately there's a kind of, to be honest, I think that happened more to some of the people I worked with as opposed to me personally, but I saw it really up close. And it's, I think people do need to understand that there is a negative economic dynamic too that kicks in. When you're a consultant, you're working with this client organization, the deeper you burrow in, the more profitable it is as a consultant, because then you just sell follow-on projects and so on. But there does come a point where you're essentially just, you're inside the firm and you're just part of its dysfunctions and you're just another bureaucratic player within it. The only way that story ends happily, I think, is when the consultant basically ends up going to work for the client. And that does happen quite a bit, as I'm sure you know. And I had colleagues who would go off and do that. I mean, I can remember I was, especially big banks and big European banks, man, they are these little worlds in themselves, giant, complex cultures. And, when you're in there, it's hard to get out. I lost some people there. Had to leave them on the field, because they really, in the end they started dressing like the client,
Yeah.
And they started, you following the same hours too. For example, that's like another big. That's when a big cultural shift, I think, happens. Right when consultants, as you know, at least in my experience, have their own idea of time and how to manage it. And it's usually pretty intense. And many client organizations have a different concept of time. But some of the consultants, they start to then behave like the client. They start to show up at the same time. They go to the office with the client. They have the ID badge. And then, then they get absorbed.
Yeah.
Absorbed into the Borg, I guess.
The Borg, yeah, exactly. Well, Matthew, this is great, but we're up against our break. Want to remind you, you can contact Ron or me by sending an email to asktsoe@verisage.com. The website is The Soul of Enterprise, where we post show notes as well as previews to upcoming shows. But right now, a word from our sponsor.
The future of online TV is here. View exclusive content from your favorite talk radio hosts and new programs that you can't see anywhere else. Visit voiceamerica.tv today.
Sage provides accountants with compliance, reporting, and analytic solutions to do more for their clients. These solutions include education programs such as the Sage Accountants Network Client Advisory Service Program. This program delivers the tools to create, package, price, market, and deliver additional services to clients, increasing your profitability and delivering more value to your clients. Let Sage help you grow your business by visiting sageaccountantsnetwork.com.
Have you ever listened to an online radio show that changed your life? I'm required to say that I have. Have you ever stopped listening to an online radio show because the commercials were mind-numbingly repetitive? Of course you haven't, because you're here right now. Look, you don't have to listen to me anymore. There's a commercial-free version of this show, and it only costs $10 a month. And for $15 a month, you get no commercials plus bonus content. Go to patreon.com/TSOE, subscribe now, and be free. You're worth it.
From the boardroom to you, Voice America Business Network.
You are tuned into The Soul of Enterprise with Ron Baker and Ed Klass. To find out more about our show, visit us on the web at thesoulofenterprise.com. You can also chat with us on Twitter using #AskTSOE. Now, back to The Soul of Enterprise.
Well, welcome back, everybody. We're here with Matthew Stewart, the author of The Management Myth. And Matthew, if you want to get Ed really upset, say something like, if you can't measure it, you can't manage it, and then attribute that saying to Peter Drucker. We've kind of combed through Drucker. He never really did say it. The closest I could find of anybody who said it was Marvin Bauer from McKinsey, called the McKinsey Maxim. But here's my question, kind of like Ed's meta question. How do you measure the effectiveness of management itself?
Yeah, that's a good question. Let me start with Peter Drucker, by the way, because, I was, I think, more sympathetic to him than to some of the other gurus. And I think that, while I don't remember about the specifics on if you can't measure, you can't manage it, I do think that he had a concept of management by objectives.
He did.
Which I think was important. And, but I think that, you know, he was subtle enough to understand that objectives are not necessarily always quantitative. They're not just some number that you aim to maximize, but rather a more general concept. So, I think Drucker was had some insight. I thought in terms of his personality, there was something kind of vain about him. Really wanted to be seen as the top management guru, but that's a separate issue. Yeah. Now to your question though, about how do you measure management? I don't like the idea of positing that there is a single measure. I think it's important to understand that management in our society has a number of really important functions. But those functions are more like, to some degree, they're more like duties than they are objectives. What I mean by that is, let me put it another way. Something that I think a lot of people have trouble accepting, but I think it's fundamentally true, is that while we function in a market in some general sense, management is, to an important degree, something that's kind of on the side of or before or just outside of the market. That is, it's organizing people to compete, but within the managerial space, it's doing something that isn't quite the same thing as a market. And I think that's part of the reason why you can't really measure it in terms of just numbers and treat it as if you're going to have a clearing market and so on, because it's precisely something that human needs in order to be able to function in a competitive market, but it's separate. So those things that management does, those functions, I'm suggesting that there's something like duties, are things like establishing the basis for cooperation, right? Building trust, or providing leadership. I mean, these things sound kind of, you know, plain vanilla and highfalutin and so on, but at the end of the day, if you didn't need that, you probably wouldn't really need management. You could, in fact, just, you know, put the numbers out there and just have people, you know, get their little things, their things punched and filled without any kind of management. And, you know, fortunately or unfortunately, human beings don't work that way. You need to get them to work together. And I think that's one of the really important things that management does. And so I think precisely for that reason, I know this is very abstract and it's 4:00 on a Friday, so who knows why we're doing it. But it's very abstract, but I think it's still a very important point that I think that it's fundamentally a mistake to think that you are going to be able to measure management in some precise way. There are things you can measure. There are definitely quantitative tools you want to use, but the kinds of things you're trying to accomplish with it ultimately are the kinds of things that have to be judged in a different way, in a more, you know, value-based way.
Right, right. I think judgment is so much more important in a lot of areas than measurement itself. I mean, you wrote that our motto might well have been, if you can't manage it, measure it. And it seems like a lot of organizations do that. Well, the more we measure, the more we'll accomplish. And I actually think the most precious things in life can't be measured. I mean, I think about the Declaration of Independence, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Tell me how you measure that. But how ideal are those principles that we all aspire to? And that can't be measured. I just think the whole cult of measurement drives me crazy, just like, you know, it bleeds through your book too, and it bleeds through our work. We hate it.
Yeah, I think Ryan, you're really right that it's often used as a shield to avoid doing what you're supposed to be doing, right? I mean, so it's basically you say, well, I've measured it, you know, and I've maximized whatever this little number is that I've decided is or I'm pretending is the right thing to do, and then that just becomes an excuse for not doing what you're actually supposed to do. So I think it's you know, you're really quite right to say that it's not just a kind of a mistake or something that is suboptimal. In fact, it's often a way of avoiding, you know, facing the facts.
And it's just like you talked about Robert McNamara and his, you know, one metric body count during the Vietnam War, which he apologized for later in his biography, I think, or his autobiography. But we always joke that if Disney had hired efficiency experts, or maybe Frederick Winslow Taylor himself, he would have ended up producing Snow White and the Three Dwarfs. So yeah. Efficiency can come at the expense of doing the right thing. And that's where it gets really dangerous.
Yeah, there is a point where another thing that happens is that that quest for precision gets to the point where it's, of course, extremely inefficient to look for that extra precision, right? Because, you know, as Aristotle famously said, there, you know, you should only look for as much precision as the subject will admit. So, you know, we have to recognize that fact. It's nice that you mentioned Robert McNamara, because I think he is such an interesting case. It's very familiar now. There was that great documentary. I can't remember the famous director involved, but, you know, he is this tragic figure because he's sort of aware of this problem and somehow he can't get out of it. Because he's got that number thing. He was raised as a whiz kid, right?
Nice kid. Sort of, yeah.
Brought up from the very beginning saying, you are the A+ student. You're the one who can add up, you know, 15-digit numbers in your head. So therefore, all the answers are going to come in the form of these numbers. And then he's in the Vietnam War and he realizes that, we realize that doesn't give you the answer that matters.
Matthew, the other thing that you wrote that I think this is absolutely profound, and I think only a philosopher could have written this. You said, theory X and theory Y depend on theory U for utopian. And you say, really, it's about theory T for tragic, Shakespeare, our framers, the ancient Greeks, maybe without Plato. But most successful managers are T types. Unpack that for us, because I think that's phenomenal.
Yeah, so I one thing I noticed in the literature is that you can say that I think you can safely say that 95% of management literature is utopian. And by that I mean that it basically says there is an answer. Once you apply this answer, all conflict will go away. Every constituency will go home happy. All transactions will clear. And you just need to buy this book to make that happen. That's the utopian thing. And yet, I think most people will recognize that in real experience, there are these irresolvable conflicts, or these conflicts that are so deep that it'll take a very, very long time to resolve them. And I think that we can recognize that successful managers often are the ones who can, in some way, recognize those conflicts and straddle them and not pretend that they're going to go away. that then becomes, you know, the basis for more successful leadership. I mean, I think in terms not just of you know, managers, of course, more general paradigms of leadership. I mean, for me, someone like Abraham Lincoln is a tremendous example of a tragic leader, right? He's kind of a tragic pragmatist. He wants to get things done. He knows you have to get things done in order to have an impact. But he also recognizes that you're not going to get it done in a way that's going to satisfy everybody. You're not going to get it done in a way that you know, leads to a sort of utopia where everyone's on the beach and, you know, sipping a lovely cocktail and smiling all day long. So I think that tragic sense is really important for people to understand. I think it's the root also of our appreciation of complexity. So I guess I wanted to draw attention to that. And I appreciate you bringing up theory U and theory T. I mean, okay, you know, we need these heuristics, and I'm happy to, you know, I figure if theory X and theory Y were a little bit impoverished, because that's, you know, it's only two, and so I wanted to have more.
Right. Well, it reminded me of Thomas Sowell's book, A Conflict of Visions, where he talks about the constrained and unconstrained view of man. Same type of thinking. I just thought it was a brilliant insight to apply it where you did. We couldn't agree more with you that business is not a profession. Ed's got a great saying, business ain't science. But let me ask you this, because you take on this issue too, and Peter Drucker did in his own way as well. He thought business was a branch of humanities, basically. And do you think, Matthew, we'd be better? And this is a impractical question, but I can do that because I'm out talking to a philosopher. Would society be better off without business schools?
Wow. Yeah. I mean, I don't have a lot of friends at the business schools, or at least they're friendly to me, but they often don't really want to hear too much from me. Here's one thing I think we can safely say: we don't need anywhere near as many business degrees as we have. So I think that is something I will stick with. At the other end of the spectrum, I mean, I think, of course, it makes sense to study business in a systematic way, and I would want to keep some of that. But I think that the deeper issue is that we've pursued a very limited idea of education, right? So we have fallen increasingly into this, you know, training idea of education, right? The idea that the only purpose of getting these degrees is to give you a very specific skill to solve a specific kind of problem that you will then be hired to do, right? So we, you know, it's kind of like saying that we teach you here how to drill holes in granite blocks, and when you get a job, you're going to get a job drilling holes in granite blocks. And, you know, with due respect to stonemasons and so on, that kind of training is not really what's appropriate for most people involved in managerial things. And honestly, that extends even into the more specialized professions. It certainly is the case in management consulting. I mean, I trot myself out as an example. I studied philosophy, and it honestly didn't make a bit of difference whether I'd gone to business school or studied philosophy. I don't think it would have mattered at all, except I think the philosophy was better. But I think it's true for many other people, and there's just so much empirical evidence to back this up. You have, you know, lawyers who then go to work as consultants, and they do perfectly well or better, and astrophysicists and so on. So we need to have a broader idea of what education is, what it can do. I think the humanities is definitely a part of that. There's a whole critique of the humanities that we could go into, but I don't think this is the right place to do it. So I don't want to just endorse it as it is, but I think if we can, you know, adopt this this different and in some ways older idea of education, we would be better off. And yeah, those business schools have to go. I mean, it's crazy. It's crazy. I mean, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars now that students spend. We all know it's kind of a signaling device to some degree, right? They're just paying the money so they can flash it out there. We know it's a networking device, but I mean, come on, there are other ways to build the network, and, you know, having that sort of exclusive leafy campus as the basis for networking is in some ways suboptimal. So I think we could do a lot better. And to add still more complexity to it, by the way, there's there business education is itself a kind of big animal, and there's a huge part of it that is undergraduate, not prestige. It's sort of licensing type degrees. And then there's another part which tends to get more attention. We tend to think about it more if you're kind of a member of the talking elite. And that, of course, is the selective university business schools that give their more fancy degrees. And those are two different worlds. I think the problems there are very different and should be managed differently. And on the undergraduate side, my feeling is that there's way too much of that. I mean, it's a shame, really, that, you know, college education can be very helpful to a lot of people. It definitely opens doors, but you bring them in and you have them study these kind of very narrow and often uninteresting and subjects, and it's just not appropriate. I mean, yes, they want to get jobs, but let's actually, you know, prepare them for a full life and hope that helps them get the jobs rather than give them a sort of artificial training. Right. Anyway, you obviously pushed the button there.
No. Like you say, it's all about people, and the key has never been to study human relations. It's to become a better person. I just absolutely love that. Well, Matthew, this has been a real honor to have you on. Ed is going to take you home, but I just want to say thank you so much. This has been great. And folks, we'd like to remind you, if you want to contact me or Ed, send us an email to asktsoe@verisage.com. And now we want to hear from our sponsors and Ed's employer, Sage.
Follow us on Twitter at VoiceAmericaTRN. Get the lowdown on guests, new shows, and your favorites. That's VoiceAmericaTRN.
Sage provides accountants with compliance, reporting, and analytic solutions to do more for their clients. These solutions include education programs such as the Sage Accountants Network Client Advisory Service Program. This program delivers the tools to create, package, price, market, and deliver additional services to clients, increasing your profitability and delivering more value to your clients. Let Sage help you grow your business by visiting sageaccountantsnetwork.com.
Have you ever been so annoyed by a commercial for a $5 ebook that you were willing to pay $10 to never hear it again? I sure have. Hello, I'm Greg Kite. Over the last several years, you've come to hate me, and I hate me too. By now, you know that for $5, you can get a copy of Ron and Ed's book. What you might not know is, for twice that much every month for forever, you can stop hearing me plug Ron and Ed's book, which totally makes sense, like the Diamond Water Paradox. Go to patreon.com/TSOE and subscribe today. Please, for the love of God, make it stop!
When it comes to business, you'll find the experts here. Voice America Business Network.
We're tuned into The Soul of Enterprise with Ron Baker and Ed Kless. To find out more about our show, visit us on the web at thesoulofenterprise.com. You can also chat with us on Twitter using #AskTSOE. Now, back to The Soul of Enterprise.
We are on with Matthew Stewart, the author of The Management Myth, Debunking Modern Business Philosophy. Also, his books include The Courtier and the Heretic, Leibniz, Spinoza, and the Fate of God in the Modern World, and Nature's God, The Heretical Origins of the American Republic, and the upcoming book, The 9.9%, The New Aristocracy That is Entrenching Inequality and Warping Our Culture. Matthew, please come back on, and after that book is out, we'd love to talk to you about that as well. But let's finish up on the management myth conversation so we can put this to bed. In doing the research for our interview today and revisiting your work, I came across this sentence, and it says, Americans often fell in love with the effects of science, not the method. And man, that struck me with regard to what we're seeing with regard to COVID-19. And we had a guest about a month ago, Donald Hoffman, who is at UC Irvine and has his book is called the Case Against Reality, which we'll let you take into that. But he said this. He said science isn't dogmatic, but scientists are. And I think the same thing is happening with in leadership management today. There's a lot of dogma that has really no basis in fact. So talk a little about your observations of that.
Yeah, I think that's a really important thing because, of course, I was struck when I approached the management literature that there was this basically false idea of scientific management. But buried within that is a certain false idea about science, as you say, right? Because science properly understood is really this kind of pursuit of knowledge that comes with quite a bit of doubt. I mean, it comes with a recognition of the limits of our knowledge. And it comes also with a, you know, a high degree of openness. And it also comes with, if it's done right, it comes with quite a bit of openness to distinct fields and methods of inquiry and so on. But it's often associated with the idea that actually what it's going to give you is, you know, something absolutely rock hard, unquestionable, fixed for all time. That's the dogma, right? That's the idea that, no, I don't need to go any farther. I don't need to actually collect any more evidence because I know the answer and it comes from science, this thing called science. So yeah, we need to think about our idea of science and improve it. So that's a really, really interesting point. Of course, I want to bash management first, but then I also want to bash this idea of science so we can improve that as well. And it's really important, as you say, like, you know, now it's a, you know, the COVID thing where it makes it an important life or death issue, and also one that dramatically affects the economy. So, you know, nothing could be more important right now than to understand what science is and also what it isn't.
Nothing is less scientific than the phrase, it's settled science.
Right. Yeah, that's fair enough. Yeah.
You know, the science is settled. Well, then by definition, it's not science, right? That's we're supposed to be questioning it. That's the point. Wanted to share with you something. One of the other business philosophers and, in fact, CEO that I'm a big fan of is John Mackey at Whole Foods. And he has a really interesting way of thinking about business and profitability in that he says his profit is like the red blood cells in your body. It's not the you die without red blood cells, but you don't think, hey, I got to make red blood cells today. That's not why you wake up in the morning. And he also compares businesses with giraffes. And he says, you know, people see businesses making a profit as surviving. And say, therefore, they must be in business to create a profit. The reality is you're in business for some other purpose. And the ones that survive happen to have profits, just like the giraffes that survive happens to be the one that have longer and longer necks to get to the higher and higher leaves. So what is your thoughts on purpose in business?
Right. You know, and by the way, we had this Peter Drucker thread, and I think Peter Drucker says something along those lines that the purpose of a business is not actually to make a profit. That's the sort of necessary condition, but it has other purposes. You know, I always liked that even though I did bash them too a bit, the human relations school, they had this one wonderful point, which is that, look, the reality is that businesses exist in the world and in a complex society, and they have they serve very important purposes in our society, and you have to understand what they do in that context. You can't say that a car manufacturer or a vaccine maker or a bank, that they are there just to get some number at the end of the year. You have to say, in fact, that they're there to, you know, help with the transportation to advance human health or to facilitate transactions. So you need to have this broader sense of purpose. And at some point, I think that does involve referring to what it does for, you know, for human beings, how it's supportive of a society that works, you know, where people have freedom and at the same time they're productive. So I don't think there's a simple answer to your question of purpose, but it's very, very important to raise it and very important to understand that these kind of narrow ideas, that it's just there to, you know, they're the classic phrase, you know, the United States Steel is not in the business of making steel, it's in the business of making money. That was a classic line. It's not adequate. It's not adequate because it doesn't explain what's really going on or how you're going to make it better.
All right. I'm going to do something totally unfair to you, Matthew. 30 seconds, the 9.9%. What do you got?
Well, 9.9%. Look, I hope people will take a look. It's a book coming out in 5 months. I want to draw attention to changes that are happening in American society. I think that We've had nothing stays still. I think we've had a rapid escalation in inequality and a kind of fragmentation that's resulted from that. And that's changed the way that we think individually. It changes the way we behave, not just it's not something that just impacts our wallets, it impacts our minds. And that's the issue that I want to address.
Well, outstanding. We look forward to reading it and having you back on to discuss it. Ron, what do we got coming up next week?
We got Dre Baldwin, Ed, and he's a basketball player, and he's going to tell us his story.
All right. Well, I look forward to it. I'll see you in 167 hours.
This has been the Soul of Enterprise, Business and the Knowledge Economy, sponsored by Sage, transforming the way people think and work so their organizations can thrive. Join us next week, folks, on Friday at 12 p.m. We're changing our time, Ed. Mm-hmm. 12 p.m. Pacific to moving up an hour. In the meantime, feel free to check us out at thesoulofenterprise.com. We'll post full show notes with our interview with Matthew, links where you can find his work and him. And you can also contact me or Ed at asktsoe@verisage.com. Thanks for listening, folks. Have a great weekend.